London was founded by the Italians in 46 AD. It was a military base called Londinium. Does that give a present-day Italian person the right to come to London and take my home?
Of course not.
Of course not. However, yeah. Our entire international setup says the exact process that I've just described to you is acceptable in Palestine. That's the crux of the issue.
The five permanent members of the United Nations Security Council, which is China, France, Russia, the UK, and the United States, have all stated that they are in favor of a two-state solution. Is there any realistic chance that this could actually happen?
The two-state solution, unfortunately, was a mirage for a future which never existed. The level at which the United States has some form of responsibility in this, in terms of these war crimes, is massive. What you're now seeing is the United States take even more of, you know, Israel having this Ukraine-like place in terms of the US budget. And that's not usual. That's not usual. And also, that's not sustainable.
Very honored to welcome in Lowkey. He is a British Iraqi hip hop artist, academic, and political campaigner. He is a patron of the Stop the War Coalition, Palestine Solidarity Campaign, and the Peace and Justice Project, who also holds a master's in Middle Eastern Studies from SOAS University. Lowkey, I want to thank you for joining today's program and discussing this important topic of Israel and Palestine.
Thank you very much for having me, Cyrus. I appreciate the invitation.
Absolutely. Now, Lowkey, you've been an outspoken voice for the Palestinian movement, and I want you to open up today's interview letting our audience know about your experience. To most of the world, an area like Gaza is completely cut off. We only know it through photos and videos, but I know that you have spent a lot of personal time in Gaza. So can you tell us what you've seen there and really what you've learned from your ample time in the area and the region?
I would not say that I've spent a long time in Gaza. I visited it in 2009 on the Viva Palestina convoy, during which we were detained by the Egyptian government for around 5 days, and then eventually were allowed to go into Gaza and deliver the aid that we had gathered in the United States and in Britain. Obviously, Gaza was in, at that time, a massively dilapidated state following Operation Castled at the end of 2008 and 2009, which saw over 1,400 Palestinians killed, the use of white phosphorus, again, the bombing of civilian locations like UN sites, like schools. And essentially, what I saw when we got to the other side after a really interesting and telling demonstration of the Egyptian government's at that time complete complicity with Israeli policies. You know, the siege on Gaza, supported by the United States, enforced by Egypt and imposed by the Israelis. What we were attempting to do was to break that siege, and it was led by a British member of parliament at that time. So while I saw in the Palestinians in Gaza a great amount of steadfastness, I saw a will to live, I saw a will to love in what were conditions imposed upon them that were deeply, deeply inhumane. My experience there, I would say, was not comprehensive. It was a very short visit. I later spent almost a year in Nablus, which is in the West Bank.
Okay.
And is a slightly different situation. You have the Palestinian Authority there, which essentially serves as a subcontractor of the Israeli occupation. There is constant security coordination between the Israelis and the Palestinian Authority. The Palestinian Authority is trained and managed by former British intelligence officers, a company called Adam Smith International. The neoliberal era has seen a lot of the functions of the state outsourced to these private companies, staffed generally by people who used to do that within the state. And so with the integration of British and Israeli security services, what you have is Britain outsourcing particular functions to the Israelis, and the Israelis outsourcing particular functions to the British. And those come in the guise of private British or private Israeli companies. But as I say, they are staffed by former security officials of both of those entities. And so the Palestinian Authority, it has a quota on how many people can be trained within it, what they can be trained in, the use of what type of firearms they can be trained in. So, for instance, the British have diktats which come to them from the US and the Israelis that they can only train Palestinian Authority security forces in the use of weapons that can be used at close range, nothing close to snipers or anything like that. And so the Palestinian Authority are tasked with maintaining the political suppression of the Palestinian population in the West Bank. And so, I saw that up close, but I wouldn't pretend that I was privy to any special secret by being there. I believe ultimately that people from the outside of this situation can see it fairly clearly for what it is without necessarily having to go there.
Right.
Obviously, my way in, I was detained by the Israelis and questioned extensively. They had a lot of data about me, about who I was, about my background, about my music.
Right.
And ultimately, I was surprised to be allowed in. I do not believe that I would be allowed in today.
Right, right. Well, I think one of the key things I took away from that, Lowkey, is that you saw this will for live and this, this desire, this hunger from the Palestinians, certainly for a better opportunity, more opportunities in the future, certainly more freedom. I think it's been very interesting to observe this fallout from October 7th. And I think what's interesting is it's brought a lot more people to the conversation, a lot more people that have never really seen, the struggle between Israel and Palestine and really for the Palestinians who, have been displaced, since the founding of Israel. A lot of people haven't seen that. This is quite interesting. On Instagram, Palestinian journalists and digital creators documenting Gaza strikes see a surge in followers. I noticed here, this is one of the, really outstanding accounts. I might pronounce this incorrectly, but this is Motaz Aziza. Who has, I think he's gained over 15 million followers in the last, 6 weeks or so, really documenting a lot of these images that we're seeing out of Palestine. For example, on Instagram, the hashtag Free Palestine has over 6.7 million posts, while the hashtag Stand With Israel has garnered around 255,000. Why do you think we're seeing this large difference?
I think ultimately, because you are talking about an asymmetric equation. The Palestinians do not have a military. They do not have an infrastructure which will produce propaganda within the accepted forms of mainstream media. The Palestinians have been aching to be free and have been subject to a form of settler colonialism for around over 100 years, actually, at this stage, when we look at the Zionist movement from its inception. And so there has, for a long time, been an understanding that if you want to present the pro-Palestinian side of the story, you are omitted from the news agenda. So there would be so many hurdles to get through before you even get to the point when the humanhood of Palestinians is properly presented. And so therefore, social media has within it less, still some, but less of a filter to that information. And so you have these inspirational young people like Marteza Aziza, who you mentioned, taking to Instagram and being able to upload directly what he's seeing in Gaza. And there is a real hunger in the world to see what is happening in Gaza on the other end of the propaganda which is fed to them. The spokespeople for the Israeli military, like Mark Regev and others, are never off the TV screens in the English language media. Right. You very rarely see a somebody who's speaking in support of the Palestinians on the screen if they are not embattled by hostile questioning, which, is akin to interrogation.
Right.
And so people are searching for a different way to understand the Palestinian story. And Martez has, at great risk to himself. We cannot forget that across this period, Israel has killed over 65 journalists. That's just in this period. You know, it was found that across the last few decades, Israel had killed 55 journalists. So in the space of a month, it's managed to outdo the amount of journalists that had been killed by Israel during this period. You know, when we think of the journalists killed by Israel, it's not just Palestinians. You have the example of James Miller, the British journalist. You have an example of Shireen Abu Akleh, who was a US citizen. These people were killed often with the words press emblazoned across their chests. So for Mu'tez to take this risk, and others like Wael Dahdouh from Al Jazeera, who his entire family were killed by the Israelis. You have to remember that Israel has the population registry for Gaza. If you are a journalist and you are traveling back and forth, you give your information to have your recognition as an international journalist working for an international news agency like Al Jazeera.
Right.
There are people in situations where they are wishing they hadn't given their information because Israel is directly, you know, you have the example of Anas al-Sharif, the Al Jazeera Arabic correspondent, who has in the last few days received direct threats from the Israelis and asking him to stop his work in the north of Gaza because he was, up until the truce, one of the only journalists still in the north of Gaza. Ultimately, Israel has many different mechanisms through which it works to suppress coverage of what it does. These fantastic, inspirational young people are breaking through that wall, that invisible wall, and they are being greatly received by millions of people around the world. It's an inspirational thing to see, but of course, very harrowing images are coming out from their accounts.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think it's truly we live in the social media age. I mean, this is the point where if a conflict happens, I mean, you're really just a few seconds away from uploading that on a platform like an Instagram or Twitter. And I think that has really shown a very big difference. For example, I remember when the United States, when we launched our war on terror in the Middle East, I mean, this was well before social media. And I don't think really a lot of Americans had really any idea what was going on over there in the Middle East. Obviously, you know, we could only hear what was presented to us on the news. There was certainly nobody on the ground sharing live footage or this just happened 5 seconds ago. Here's an Instagram video. Shows the world that we live in right now, why social media is so important and why a lot of people are turning to social media like an Instagram and following these press, these photographers there. I think it's really is an amazing thing to see as we get a better picture of this. I want to shift here now to specifically October 7th, because that is obviously the conflict point. And, you know, obviously that changed the entire future of Israel and Palestine forever. On one side, we see October 7th as the biggest attack against the Jewish people since the Holocaust. But I think it's also caused a lot of people, like we've mentioned, you know, to be finally paying attention to the plight of the Palestinian peoples. What are your thoughts on the attack on October 7th? How do you look at that? How do you process that? And I wanted to ask that because I know when you were interviewed by Piers Morgan, it was very fresh after that. We didn't have a lot of information. Now it's almost 7 weeks later. We know a lot more about October 7th. As of today, what is your thoughts on this attack and how things have transpired?
Well, to start with, Israel's prized unit 8200, which is the signals intelligence unit, the equivalent of GCHQ in England. It monitors and surveils Palestinian communications. It's been found by whistleblowers within that unit to use that information to blackmail Palestinians. This unit was seemingly at that time not working on the weekends, which is really something to behold. Wow. When you also look at the military operation that took place, you saw the launching of an unprecedented amount of rockets to disorientate the Iron Dome system of Rafael, the Israeli arms company, and Raytheon, the US arms company. You know, a lot has gone into the Iron Dome, and it was disorientated in that moment. You then saw the taking of key military posts with people coming over the fence in hand gliders. You know, you have to remember that Palestinians attempted to walk towards the fence around Gaza in 2018 in something known as the Great March of Return. And they were practicing their right under UN Resolution 194, paragraph 11, which gives Palestinians the right to return home. What happened when they attempted to do that? Peacefully walk towards the fence, Israel snipered and injured thousands of them, killed hundreds of them. Among them was the journalist Yasser Murtaja, who had the word press written across his chest. Among them was the medic Razan Najjar. You also saw during that time Gaza become a city of amputees, with thousands of people being targeted directly in their knees by Israeli snipers. You know, as JFK said, those who make peaceful revolution impossible make violent revolution inevitable. Now, that is to understand what happened on that day. But what you did see was the closest military post to Gaza is the Erez crossing. Now, at the point when it was taken over by fighters from Gaza, you found Brigadier General Rosenfeld of the Israeli military cocoon himself in his office and call in an airstrike on his own base. Now, this is very likely to be the application of a directive which exists within the Israeli military, known as the Hannibal Doctrine, the Hannibal Directive, which states that when in a position of danger in terms of hostage taking by the other side, then dangerous actions like indiscriminate bombing can be carried out by the Israeli military. And the Erez crossing was not the only place where that took place. And this has, of course, been documented in Haaretz by Amos Harel and others. But you also have the example of Kibbutz Be'eri. The testimony of Yasmin Porat has been widely spread when she was taken captive by the Palestinian fighters. What her conviction is, what she claims is that the Israeli tanks came and shelled the building in which she was in with other Israeli captives, killing them, including her. Her partner was killed during that time, though it's not clear whether that was from the fire from Palestinian fighters or that was from the shelling by the Israeli military. And that's not the only place where you saw the Israeli military indiscriminately fire on people that were both Palestinian fighters and Israelis from the area. So ultimately, you saw a significant upset. As you know, Israel has worked on isolating the Palestinians, particularly in Gaza, from themselves. You know, Vladimir Jabotinsky, who actually is the most influential Zionist figure by some metrics, while Theodor Herzl is credited as the founder of Zionism, Ben Gurion is credited as a very key figure also. Jabotinsky had more influence insofar as today in the political entity of Israel, you have more hospitals, schools, cinemas, roads, parks named after Vladimir Jabotinsky than you do named after the other two. Jabotinsky was deeply inspired by Mussolini, by the fascism of Eastern Europe, and he was somebody who had the idea of the Iron Wall being essential to protect this, as he put it, no indigenous population will accept subjugation by alien invaders. And this was the terms in which Jabotinsky talked about it. You know, those early Zionist leaders clearly understood what they were doing as colonialism. Seemingly now today, it's only for the consumption of the Western world and English language speaking media that Zionism is presented as anything other than settler colonialism. It was understood very clearly. That was a consensus across the Zionist movement. Both sides of the Zionist movement were very clear, we are colonizing this land. Now, Jabotinsky's idea of the Iron Wall, I would argue, is reflected somewhat in the case of Gaza. You are attempting to build this space that is concealed off and sealed off from yourselves. And with the case of the 7th of October, that was really penetrated in an absolutely unprecedented way. I do believe there are more testimonies coming out. There's the example of a key figure formerly of the Israeli Air Force who has described what happened on October 7th and the few days after it as mass Hannibal, the application of the mass Hannibal, which would lead us to believe that there is significant discrepancies in the way in which these events are being presented to us as incoming savage hordes from the ghetto that Israel created in Gaza.
Yeah, I think what was really interesting is I did see a member of the IDF who had come out and said, you know, originally we had counted 1,400 bodies that were burned or that were, you know, killed, but actually we overcounted because after going through, we had realized 200 of them were actually Hamas. So, yeah. You know, I think there was a big admission there. And then a lot of people immediately concluded, does that mean that Israel had friendly fired? And, you know, certainly, obviously Hamas certainly did kill a lot of people and certainly did that act on October 7th. But I think in response, I remember, you know, basically in response, there is some friendly fire as well from Israel. And I remember having a guest on the program about a month ago, and many people really chastised him for saying that, you know, that there was some friendly fire. But now here we are a month later, and it does seem that a lot more evidence is coming out that that certainly is a big part of that. So I think we're going to continue to learn more of this. And I do want to talk about now this recent development, which is certainly this temporary ceasefire. You know, it's been about 7 weeks. We have a temporary ceasefire. There has been some exchanges of hostages from Hamas, also the release of prisoners from Israel. Now, this was originally planned for 4 days. I believe they've reached now another agreement to extend this by an additional 2 days. What are your thoughts on this situation, this temporary ceasefire? You know, we've now seen humanitarian aid has started to enter into Gaza. Does this also prove that there is a potential for a political solution to this conflict?
Well, let's start at the beginning of the question. Sure. Israel is the only state in the world which processes children through military courts. Children as young as 12 can be sentenced for up to 20 years in Israeli occupation jail for the crime of throwing stones. Israel has under 10,000 Palestinians currently in jail. Some of them are children who have been imprisoned in some cases for posts on social media. Wow. Israel uses the idea of incitement on social media as a crime, which it wields against children. Also, you have the case of imprisoned without charge, arbitrary detention, which many Palestinians are subject to. And in fact, in this case, during this time when these prisoners have been released, over 50% of them were held in arbitrary detention. They had not been charged with any crime. Now, when it comes to the general charging of people, as I say, these military courts, which Israel processes these people in, have a prosecution rate of 99.8. So it means that if you enter those military courts, you are very likely to go to jail. And also, a key thing here is that across this period when Israel has released these 165 or so prisoners, it has simultaneously imprisoned new Palestinian prisoners almost the same amount during the very same period. So the point is that Zionism is a maximalist movement. It's a fantastical movement, even from the beginning. The aims that Theodor Herzl was expressing to those who would listen to him were laughed out of the room for several years before he was taken seriously. It took World War I for his idea to be taken seriously, and the Middle East being on the precipice of the British taking hold and the Ottoman Empire falling apart. Yes, it was economically weak in the late 1800s and in the early 1900s. However, it did seem fantastical, this idea of setting up a new state there. And for that reason, you had, you know, the first Aliyah, as it's called, the first movement of Zionist colonists to Palestine, was considered a failure because it employed Palestinians to till the soil. And the second Aliyah is where you got the idea of muscular kibbutzism from, because it was a necessity for these people coming from the Pale Settlement of Russia or coming from Eastern Europe and Western Europe in some cases, though, you know, while it was led by Western Europe in terms of human beings, the early Aliyahs were based on people from Eastern Europe and also people from Yemen. And these people did not really know much about how to deal with the Palestinian soil. And so they had to rely on that labor. But then you had the development of something called the division of labor, which said that you had to establish different, a whole new labor market just for Jewish people, just for the new arrivals. One of the only places that didn't have that division of labor was the railways during the time of the British Mandate. But then simultaneous to that division of labor that Zionism necessitated, you also had the British Mandate having the obligation to apply the Balfour Declaration. And the Balfour Declaration had been issued at a time of war by Arthur Balfour, the foreign minister. The letter was written by Chaim Weizmann, who had helped the British develop smokeless gunpowder in World War One, and that had got him great support from the British establishment for his ideas. And so Chaim Weizmann had been able to write this document for Arthur Balfour. Balfour had issued it. And then when Herbert Samuel became the first High Commissioner of Palestine, the British Mandate, he had the obligation of applying the Balfour Declaration, which meant that the British established separate educational institutions and separate health institutions for both the Palestinian population, the Christians and Muslims, and the Jewish population. So there were separate institutions. This was the foundation of the apartheid state that Israel was and was essentially meant to be. It was, the way was led by the British in several ways. And the thing about Herbert Samuel, which is fascinating, is his son had been in the same legion in the British military in World War One, alongside Ben Gurion and Vladimir Jabotinsky, both of who would go on to lead the Zionist movement, though on differing wings of the movement. But the point is that you have an unsustainable status quo in Zionism, and it's a status quo that says the Palestinians who have lived there for generation upon generation upon generation do not have the same rights as people who have come more recently. And you have, while you have the right of return under UN Resolution 194, you have the law of return in Israeli law, which says that a person who has a grandparent that happens to be Jewish can therefore become an Israeli citizen tomorrow. They go through military conscription. They have a whole different way of settling into that society than people who have lived there for many generations. And so the point is you cannot conceivably see any form of peace or just solution there as long as you prop up this fantastical understanding, which is the constant back projection of somebody else. London was founded by the Italians in 46 AD. It was a military base called Londinium. It's founded by the Romans, right?
Okay.
Does that give a present day Italian person the right to come to London and take my home?
Right.
I'm asking you.
No, of course not. No, of course not.
Of course not. However, our entire international setup and community says the exact process that I've just described to you is acceptable in Palestine. That's the crux of the issue. That somebody who has absolutely no way of proving they have anything to do with anyone who lived 2,000 or 3,000 years ago has the right to dispossess somebody who, with generations of their family, have lived in the same house even, and they have the right to come and take that house from them. And this is the basis of the problem.
Right.
It's not about Palestinians never miss an opportunity to miss an opportunity. It's not about the intransigence of the Arabs in not absorbing the Palestinians and giving them citizenship in neighboring places. It's not about why can't the Palestinians just go to other Arab countries. It's that simple individual rights are being flouted for what is essentially a mythology.
Right.
It's a mythology. I can't tell you who I was related to 2,000, 3,000 years ago.
Right.
And I have no right to come and take even that microphone off you on the basis of who I believe I was related to 2,000, 3,000 years ago.
Right. Very powerful. I mean, Lowkey, I really commend you for your incredible knowledge of the situation. I know this has been a passion of yours for at least 15 years, as far back as my research shows, is that you've, you know, really taken this cause. I want to kind of end this with one important question. I think you have really hit on this already with, you know, the core problem here that exists. And that is certainly where I'm at right now is I think we've started to see a little bit of change from the United States. And as an American citizen myself, I know my government's close relationship with Israel. I know how much the United States, how we support, you know, Israel really indefinitely. I was encouraged when President Biden and even former President Barack Obama had said, you know, the two-state solution is something that needs to happen. Even, you know, former President Barack Obama had said, you know, return to the status quo is not going to work, and this is something has to change. And even had warned, you know, that this potential ground invasion that we've now seen unfold, you know, would result in tens of thousands of people passing away, obviously innocent civilians being the most of them. What is the chances that, you know, are basically better question, how do you foresee this conflict ending in the near term? I mean, we know that the five permanent members of the United Nations Security Council, which is China, France, Russia, the UK, and the United States, have all stated that they are in favor of a two-state solution. Is there any realistic chance that this could actually happen?
The Likud Charter, and Likud is the governing party in Israel. It has obviously entered coalition with other far-right groups, and recently a war government has been established with some of those who sought to overthrow Netanyahu over the last year. But right. The Likud party has been massively influential and been the governing party for several periods of time in recent Israeli history. In its charter, it has the following sentence: there shall be no Palestinian sovereignty between the Jordan River and the Mediterranean Sea. The two-state solution, unfortunately, was a subterfuge, was a mirage for a future which never existed. It was a way in which Israel was able to expand its settlement presence in occupied Palestine in violation of international law, build up over 500,000 settlers there, who are armed, who participate in Israeli elections, who have control of 80% of the water. It allowed Israel to establish a telecommunications system in the Palestinian. You know, you have to remember that when Oslo happened, there was between 2-4% of Palestinian population who were even connected to phone lines. And right. What happened following on from Oslo and the idea of this two-state solution was the infrastructure of the Palestinian state, the sort of skeletal infrastructure would include the foundation of these telecommunications companies. But those telecommunications companies were acted under the auspices of the Israeli Ministry of Communications, meaning all of their equipment had to pass through the IDF. Where they could and couldn't build was defined by the Israelis. And Israel had numerous mechanisms designed for them, including one by Motorola, which would allow them to encrypt the communications of the Israeli military. But then also they had hypervisibility of the Palestinians. This was Moshe Dayan's understanding of making the occupation invisible. The two-state solution and the peddling of it around the world allowed Israel to set up a hypervisibility and infrastructure in the West Bank, which could control the Palestinians more effectively with a more frictionless occupation and less direct contact with soldiers. Despite that, of course, Israel has hundreds of checkpoints across the West Bank, including flying checkpoints, which it sets up seemingly arbitrarily. And so, unfortunately, while the political elites of the region and of the world have used the two-state solution as a crutch, really, to lean on as a panacea to the issue, they say, well, the two-state solution, but you know, the key things like Al-Aqsa and the right of return were considered to be part of the final status agreement, meaning right. that while these negotiations took place, what is the core issue, which is the largest refugee population in the world, the Palestinian population, whether they have the right to come home or not, is constantly put on the back burner while you beef up and consolidate the presence of the Palestinian Authority to do Israel's job for it. So ultimately, while states in the world have a position of support for the two-state solution, you know, I don't think that really bears much significance to what is actually happening on the ground, which is continued dispossession in both a spectacular, as we're seeing in Gaza now, and right. an attritional way. And I guess the point with Biden is that while he may say these things, you have to remember that the US Delta Force has participated in this incursion into Gaza. You've seen Reaper drones from the very first day of October 7th flying above Gaza, probably helping with the Israelis' airstrikes. You've seen US citizens that the US government told to leave Gaza and go to the Rafah crossing being right. then hit with Israeli airstrikes. The level at which the United States has some form of responsibility in this in terms of these war crimes is massive. The US gives to Israel in normal times over $10 million a day in military aid. But what you also see now is because the Israeli economy is staggering because of this war, it's had to commit several hundred thousand people from the traditional economy and reserves and put them into the Israeli military. They've cut off the 60,000 Palestinian construction workers who were building in Israel. They've cut them off. So they're having to patch all of these holes within the economy. They've had to shut down the Tama gas field, which was, of course, costing it dearly. Every single day it was shut. And so what you're now seeing is the United States take even more of, you know, Israel having this Ukraine-like place in terms of the US budget. And that's not usual. That's not right. usual. And also that's not sustainable. So from right. the US perspective, you do want to lessen this situation. But Israel, as I said, it has fantastical maximalist aims, which is the emptying of Gaza of Palestinians and the pushing of them into the Sinai Desert. This is not a new thing. This is something right. that Zionist thinkers thought about hundreds of years ago. You know, right. you look at the expulsion of the Palestinians, fantastic book by Nolan Musalha. He goes into in really forensic detail the way in which Zionist thinkers foresaw the expulsion of the Palestinians, population transfer of the Palestinians being a key objective. And you know, while it seems that what the Americans would prefer would be the imposition of the Palestinian Authority on Gaza as a satrap neo-colonial puppet, the Israelis have a different idea, which is the emptying of Gaza of Palestinians. So while there are some antagonisms, ultimately the US has played a horrific role in supporting this this war on Gaza.
Yeah, it's very unfortunate, and I just can't imagine if 2 million people leave Gaza and go to the Sinai Peninsula, I don't think they would ever see that land again. And I'm not sure. I mean, there's nothing in the Sinai Peninsula. I mean, where would they go? What would they do? How do you? I remember seeing a very early video from I think he was a retired person from the IDF who had said, you know, we can send them to the Sinai. You know, there we can send some tents their way. And I'm just thinking, wow, how do you logistically get tents set up for 2 million people? How do you get water there? How do you get food? How does that last for any much longer than a couple of days? The logistics behind that is just astronomical just to move that amount of people alone. I think what's going to be interesting to see is after this humanitarian pause, Netanyahu has made it very clear that the IDF will continue its siege. It will continue eradicating Hamas. And that is obviously the goal of Israel. I certainly worry, and I think all of us around the world worry about the plight of the Palestinians and what is really going to happen, you know, for these people. So Lowkey, I want to just thank you so much for giving us all a very detailed analysis, but also a history lesson. I mean, I'm not the most educated on this. This is why I invite guests on to also, you know, learn and understand your perspective. I know you've spent a lot of time studying this, being an academic in this field. I want to thank you so much for coming on today's show.
Thank you very much, Cyrus. Great to be with you.
Absolutely. All right. Thank you, everybody. I'm going to drop Lowkey's Twitter handle down in the description below and drop us a comment on what you think of today. I look forward to seeing you all in our next video soon.